Hello, Wall Street Osmium, and welcome to episode 17 of Osmium Stuff. Feels like forever since I made one of these videos. Now, on this subreddit, you've seen a lot of my work with strictly osmium metal, particularly how inert and oxidation resistant it is, how it's resistant to aqua regia, HF and nitric acid, molecular chromic acid, iodic acid, permanganic acid, nitrosyl sulfuric acid. All of these are very strong oxidizing acids. It's even resistant to boiling 50% hydrogen peroxide, which can dissolve tungsten and rhenium both. As an added bonus, osmium is even more resistant than ruthenium to alkaline oxidizing mixtures like bleach and hydroxyl radicals. However, osmium's compounds are a profoundly different animal. To start with, we'll be looking at a compound called osmyl tetraamine chloride. To make this compound, I start with a dilute sodium osmate solution. This compound is in the +6 oxidation state. To it, I add solid ammonium chloride. Now, fairly quickly, you'll notice a yellowish precipitate forming on the bottom of the vial. This is our osmyl tetraamine chloride forming. Unfortunately, however, this compound isn't going to last because the sodium osmate was dissolved in bleach, and this reaction also produces chloramine. Now, while chloramine is not a particularly strong oxidizer, in fact it's even weaker than regular chlorine, that doesn't matter because this compound of osmium oxidizes very, very easily. Now, as the chloramine layer encroaches on the osmyl tetraamine chloride, it will begin to oxidize it to osmium tetroxide in the +8 oxidation state. And there it goes. Now, when we look at the formula for chloramine, there's no oxygen present. However, in the presence of water, the oxygen is available. However, you don't need chloramine to oxidize osmyl tetraamine chloride. In fact, all you really need is water, because boiling water alone will oxidize this compound, thus showing just how reactive some of these compounds of osmium really are. In fact, the higher the oxidation state of osmium, the more reactive the compounds get. This could be shown comparatively. Several years ago, in one of Thoisoy's videos, he showed that osmium powder reacts very, very slowly with concentrated nitric acid.
Osmium is a very stable metal. The powder of osmium reacts very poorly with the concentrated nitric acid and aqua regia.
Bear in mind that osmium metal is in the zero valency state. Let's compare that to the reaction of hydrated osmium dioxide with concentrated nitric acid. Now, bear in mind, the hydrated osmium dioxide is held in a carrier solution of water. The water is less dense than the nitric acid, so some of the hydrous osmium dioxide will simply float on top, while the rest that's pushed underneath will oxidize to osmium tetroxide, imbuing a reddish-brown color to the acid. After adding the rest and a quick swirl off camera, the rest easily oxidizes. A thin layer of crystallized osmium tetroxide can also be seen forming on the glass. So, to recap, at room temperature, compact osmium is completely resistant to concentrated nitric acid, and the powdered metal seems to react almost too slowly to observe. Whereas osmium dioxide in the tetravalent state oxidizes almost immediately under identical conditions. And then there's compounds like osmyl tetraamine chloride, which are in the hexavalent state. These are even more reactive. Of these hexavalent compounds, the osmyl nitrite salts stand out quite possibly as being one of the most unstable group of compounds. If these salts are allowed to crystallize out of solution, there are many ways it can oxidize. On contact with air, it decomposes, producing osmium tetroxide. On contact with sunlight, it rapidly decomposes, producing lots of osmium tetroxide. On contact with water, it decomposes, forming nitrous acid, which prevents the reduction to osmium dioxide and instead oxidizes it to osmium tetroxide. At this point, your best option would be to dissolve them in alcohol, so that way when they inevitably decompose, it cannot form the dreaded tetroxide. Speaking of which, by far the easiest way to make osmium tetroxide is by adding hydrochloric acid to a solution of sodium osmate and bleach. The hydrochloric acid reacts with the bleach to produce chlorine, which in the presence of water oxidizes the osmate to osmium tetroxide. Now, once you've obtained this highly dangerous, volatile, yet surprisingly stable octavalent compound, you'll be granted a wide range of possibilities. Yeah, it'll blind you if it gets in your eyes, and it'll destroy your lung tissue if you breathe it in, but it's really cool stuff. I mean, you can reduce it to the hexavalent state, you can reduce it to the tetravalent state, the divalent state, and all the oxidation states in between, probably. You can also convert it to other octavalent compounds. For example, by adding sodium hydroxide to a solution of osmium tetroxide, you get a solution of sodium perosmate, which, believe it or not, isn't volatile so long as the pH is high enough. Adding ammonia to these perosmate solutions will produce an osmiamate, all of which are yellow and are octavalent. Naturally, acidifying these perosmate solutions convert them entirely back to osmium tetroxide. Adding alcohol, however, reduces it to the hexavalent osmate. In the presence of alcohol, osmates will yield a pink to magenta color and a blue color in methanol. If lower concentrations of ethanol or methanol are added to osmate solutions, you get a slower equilibrium reaction, resulting in a myriad of different beautiful colors. Other alcohols, such as isopropyl alcohol or benzyl alcohol, can also be used to reduce the tetroxide and its perosmate solutions, and while I haven't tried any of those yet, I hope to in the future. However, these osmate solutions are only stable in neutral or alkaline conditions. Adding acid will react to produce osmal salts. In the presence of alcohol, however, adding acid will precipitate hydrated osmium dioxide, which is a great way to recycle osmium. Now I know what everyone is asking. How about reducing it to the metal? Well, that's a bit of a process, you see. The first step is to bubble sulfur dioxide gas into a solution containing osmium tetroxide and roughly 20% sodium hydroxide. This will produce a complex called sodium osmisulfite. Now, right away, there's a fundamental issue with this formula. You see, osmium trioxide only really exists at high temperatures, like 1100 degrees for example, and it only exists in the gaseous state. When it cools down, it disassociates into osmium dioxide and the tetroxide. And since hexavalent osmium is dominated by the osmal species, the formula is more than likely actually written like this. Anyway, this sodium osmisulfite complex is then reacted with hydrogen chloride gas at dull red heat to produce sodium hexachloroosmate. This hexachloroosmate salt is then converted to ammonium hexachloroosmate via double displacement reaction with ammonium chloride. This ammonium hexachloroosmate is one of a few different calcinable forms. Arguably, the best calcinable form because there's no oxygen attached to it. Calcining involves the process of heating this compound to high temperatures in hydrogen gas. This will convert it to osmium sponge. After this sponge is purified by reacting silicon dioxide impurities with hydrofluoric acid, it can then either be sintered or it can be melted in an arc furnace to produce the lovely blue metal that we all know and love. This metal is the most oxidation-resistant form of osmium, very unreactive, and completely safe to handle and wear as jewelry despite what the rest of the internet may have to say about it. I very much hope you enjoyed this video, and thank you for watching.